Well, welcome to the house of the Lord. We're glad that each of you can be here to worship the Lord together here. We thank Jamie for that beautiful violin special there. Now we're going to sing song 184. That's 184. Says, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." We'll sing the song as written, both verses.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Thankful for God's guidance. We're going to turn to song 434. That's 434. It says, "Revive us again." If we want that revival, we need to look to Him, and He will guide our feet and our path unto that. We'll sing all four verses of this song. When you're the leader and you forgot which verse you're singing. But the Lord still hears our praises, doesn't He? Next song, 772, says, "When we all get to heaven." Are you looking forward to that day? I sure am. We'll go ahead and sing verses 1, 3, and 4 of this song. 1, 3, 4.
Thank you.
that chorus one more time as a grand choir. Pick out a part, soprano, alto, tenor, bass. We'll just have the piano and keyboard play with us. Orchestra sing, please. Let's turn to song number 32 now. That's 3-2, back towards the beginning of the book. It says, "Be exalted, O God." We'll sing this song twice through. Let's turn to 479. That's 479. It says, "Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling." So thankful for his calming voice. He knows how to reach each one of us and help us to come to salvation. May the Lord help each one of us to find that. Let's sing verses 1, 2, and 4 of this song. 1, 2, and 4.
Oh,
If we're saved today, we're thankful that God called us, amen? And the call is still out for any one of us. If you still need the Lord, he wants you to have him today. Let's turn to song 217. That's 217. It says, Holy Ground. We'll sing both verses of this song. One more time, just the piano and keyboard. Song before prayer will be 708. That's 708. Behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us. First time through, we'll all sing through as one group. The orchestra will go ahead and play with this. And after that first time, we'll go ahead and stand, and we'll go ahead and do it as a round. And we'll have the orchestra behind me and myself will sing the first part, and when we get to the second part, that we should be called the sons of God, then the audience will start in the beginning, and everybody will sing the song twice through at that point. So we'll do orchestra the first verse, and then just piano keyboards on the last parts as we do the round. Thank you.
the sons of God.
That second part together.
That we should be called the sons of God. That we should be called the sons of God.
And as we look to the Lord in prayer, we'll ask Brother Derry to lead us.
Our precious, kind Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the privilege to be in your house this morning, to feel the presence of the Lord, to sing the songs of Zion, to sing about your love and about your call. We're so thankful, Lord, for the wonderful hope that you've given us. We're so thankful for your salvation and the blood of Jesus Christ that has never lost its power. We're thankful for that blood, Lord, that it covers, it washes away sin. It does a work in our hearts and our lives that nothing else can do. We're so thankful for your word. We ask for your blessing upon your word this morning, your giver of the word. We just pray that our hearts will be open to your spirit, that you will be able to talk to each and every one of us. Lead us in the paths of righteousness for thy name's sake. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Welcome to the house of God. So good to see everyone here. And we do thank Jamie for that beautiful violin prelude. In a moment, we'll hear Jacob, Michael, and Mallory sing, and before God's word, Jill will sing the last special. Come back tonight at 5 o'clock for our evening service, and this Wednesday with Youth Camp, we'll have another prayer service at 7 o'clock. There's a prayer list in the back where the higher ways are that has a list of all the campers from Port Angeles that are going to Youth Camp. Is it 21 or 22? 22 campers going from Port Angeles. So you can get that list and be praying for them by name. We know prayer works. Last Wednesday at prayer meeting, we had Sister Blanche was holding them up in the back. So pick one up and you can pray for them this week. But, you know, Sister Blanche wrote down our previous prayer meeting, the prayer request. She was just writing them on a receipt, and she pulled that receipt out last Wednesday at prayer meeting, and she was going down the list. She goes, all of these were answered. Amen. Amen. God answers prayer. Prayer works. So let's continue. If you have a prayer request, by all means, submit it. And we know prayer works. We've proven it. And let's pray. Be praying for all of those campers as well as any other needs. I know there are many with afflictions and many other great needs. The Lord wants to hear your need. He wants to hear from us, and prayer works. So with that, there will be a prayer meeting this Wednesday, 7 o'clock, right back here. We'll continue on now with Jacob, Mallory, and Michael.
Sweet and a joy complete.
Heaven's glories round me
And I am filled with gratitude that He is mine. For communion sweet and a joy complete in a fellowship of love. For a home that waits just beyond the gate of the heavenly courts above. My heart is filled with gratitude to Jesus, my Savior, for strength which daily is renewed in a fellowship divine. In communion sweet and a joy complete,
heaven's glories round me shine.
And I am filled with gratitude that He is mine.
If you'll turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 12, we'll be reading verses 22 through 34. Luke chapter 12, 22 to 34. And He said unto His disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, neither for the body, what ye shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. Consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are ye better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to his stature one cubit? If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow, they toil not, they spin not, and yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O ye of little faith? And seek not ye what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, neither be ye of doubtful mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell that ye have, and give alms. Provide yourselves bags which wax not old, a treasure in the heavens that faileth not, where no thief approacheth, neither moth corrupteth. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also.
Pressed in to see this man who stood condemned to die. A man they once proclaimed as king, they now would crucify. They laid a cross upon his back and pushed him up the road. The path would lead to Calvary. He fell beneath the as I watched, I understood the burden that he bore was more than just a heavy tree. The weight was so much more. The weight of the cross the weight of the tree that was carried by him. My guilt and disgrace Jesus bore in my place. On Calvary's road, neath the weight was scarred, his body bruised, his head was crowned with thorns. The crowd now jeered and cursed his name, the object of their scorn. He never spoke a word to them, the silent Lamb of God. This man of sorrow bore the cross he chose to carry on. I saw a love beyond the pain, as if he knew his sacrifice and loss would be my gain. The weight of the cross was the weight of my sin, not the weight of the tree that was carried by him. My guilt and disgrace Jesus bore in my place. On the weight of the cross, on which the Prince of Glory died.
We'll read again in Luke chapter 12, rereading verse 34. It says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." Looked up the word treasure, the definition, and you probably pretty much know it. It said things like a precious gem, gold, money, things like that, but it also said something precious to you. Yes, right. Which, when we think about that, is probably more of the application here. It says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Yes. Came across an account. A man was on a sinking ship. He was on the deck, and he was told by the crew member to hurry up and get on into the last remaining lifeboat. Yet he pondered. There's not much time. The crew member shouted to him, "If you don't hurry, you're going to miss." And it was the last boat. And the rate the ship was sinking, he said, "We need to launch it quickly or we'll all be pulled down with the ship." The man looked at the lifeboat and he looked back towards a door in the ship which led down to his quarters, and back and forth he was pondering what to do, and eventually he ran down back into where his quarters were. He yelled, "I have to go get my money." And so he ran down towards his cabin, never to be seen again. What was his treasure? It was his money. What is your treasure? It says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." We can just automatically know that to be true just by pondering the things that you love in life. I think, what is my treasure? Yes, I love the Lord with all my heart. That's my number one treasure. But then from there, I go to my family and things that are really dear to me. That's where my heart is. Yes, right. I love to be in the house of the Lord. I love to come to worship and hear stories of victory like we did last Wednesday. All these prayer requests answered. God is still working, and that's where I want to keep my treasure. The question I'd like to ask you this morning is, where is your treasure? Yes, right. Jesus spoke these words to his disciples with the purpose of letting him know he was going to take care of them. And planning this sermon, I hadn't read the Sunday school lesson until last night, and I realized that these were many of the scriptures that were in our Sunday school lesson today. But the Lord was saying to them, don't worry, but rather lay up your treasures in heaven. If I can take care of the ravens, if I can take care of the lilies, if I can take care of all these things, I can take care of you. And he was addressing the two major issues of everyday life, food and clothing. And those would be very high in just about everyone's book. We worry about those things. Although I don't believe any of us here are in any immediate danger of starving to death. But we do wonder, what are we going to eat? What's for lunch? Right now, I don't even know. I'm not worried, though. I'm not worried. But we do worry when maybe the cupboards look low. That doesn't ever hardly mean there's nothing to eat, just maybe not what we want to. We worry about what we're going to wear. I worried about that this morning. What suit am I going to put on? What shirt? What tie? And I should have asked Lisa. But which outfit? Are the colors right? Do they match? Jesus spoke these words on the heels of the parable of the man who tore down his barns and built bigger barns. A man whose treasure was his stuff. He had stuff. You know, we probably all have things that we treasure. Maybe it was handed down to you from grandfather, maybe even farther back, something that had been in your family, and we treasure these things. Why? Because it was somebody before ours, and they gave it to us. Well, this man had made his treasure his goods, fruits and goods, and lots of it, so much that his barns, it says his barns, that's plural, couldn't hold it all. He had a lot of stuff. Putting it in today's words, he was saying, I need more sheds or bigger sheds. And that's basically what happens. You get a shed and you fill it and you need a bigger one. Anybody know that? I do. Really, though, the things that he had accumulated weren't the problem. The problem came when he let the things, the stuff, become his treasure. his goods became what he cherished. It became what he lived for. And that's what consumed his thought. That's what consumed his life. I need to tear down these barns. I need bigger barns. Really, your treasure could be anything. Your treasure could be anything that has a value to you, or something that you just feel is the most important thing in your life. Whatever's number one is your treasure. And that is a fact. This man's treasure just happened to be his riches. And it sounds like he was very wealthy. That's what he trusted in. That's what he put his stock in. Everything that he had, and I just need to store more. I just sound like he was a hoarder of his goods. But just like that man on the sinking ship, he found out that it can't be taken with you after this life. I wonder if, given the choice now, looking in hindsight, if he probably wouldn't give all of his money, all of his goods, for his life. Like the man running back to get his money out of his cabin down there, what good is that? What good was his treasure? We're all separated from it. Both men, the man in the parable and the man in the ship, lost it all. They couldn't take it with them. In verse 20, Jacob read, "But God said unto him," oh no, this is the chapter before. Verse 20, "God said unto him, Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided?" You see, if you don't treasure the Lord first and put him very first, everything else will disappear. Everything else is temporary. Everything is really short term. As James put it, our life is a vapor. It's here and then it's gone. Just that little bit of steam. Just there, it's in, you see it in the air and then it's gone a couple feet. Well, that's what he likened our lives to. Yeah. So where is your treasure? Are you putting it in things that cannot be taken away? Because everything vanishes. Verse 21, it says, it finished saying, "So is he that layeth up treasures for himself and is not rich towards God." That's where you want to be rich, towards God. You want to invest everything you have that way. We look at life and we see people put so much effort into themselves, even these bodies, which get old. People do, if you find a cream or something that makes you look young and you can market that, you're going to get rich. Why? Because people care. People are so worried about what they put into this life and what they put into how they look. Where is your treasure? The treasure that we want to lay up is eternal is that the things of the Lord. Lay up, be rich towards God. It's the only thing that will matter. Everything else, just temporary. But if you lay up treasures in heaven, those are treasures that we can never lose. That's also the thing that your heart will be focused on. If someone's treasure could be work, and they'll put so much effort and time into work, and it just consumes their schedule, it consumes everything, every waking moment of their life. They go to sleep worrying about work. They wake up worrying about work. They go to work and worry about work. That's their treasure. We want our treasure. I want to go to bed worrying about the things of the Lord. I want to wake up talking to the Lord. I want my middle of my day to be talking to the Lord. That's going to last. That's going to be eternal. If God is on your heart, That's where your treasure is, and that's what you'll be thinking about. The Lord says, make me your treasure. He knows the things that you have need of. He knows the food, the clothing, and everything else. In Sunday school, we made a big list of all the needs that we had in different ages of life. It was quite interesting to see all as life goes. You start out worrying about your toys. You get older, you just, things progress. You worry about shelter, you worry about school, college, who I'm going to marry, and it just grew, it grew. And you get up to where you're a senior, even a will was mentioned. We want to worry about the things of the Lord, the things of God. The Lord said in verse 24 of our text, I take care of the fowls of the air. He feeds the birds. And sometimes he uses me to do it. You can ask my family. Everywhere I go, I throw bread out and because I like to see them come and eat it. But I think it's more than that. The Lord's taking care of the birds. Yeah. I think I'm feeding them, but the Lord is taking care of them. Yeah. He cares when the sparrow falls, and yet he cares more for you. Amen. And I've often been reminded out there 60 miles offshore in the middle of the night where we're setting hooks at 4 a.m. in the dark, and that little sparrow came and landed on the deck. He was lost. Mm-hmm. And he came, and there he was, the man across from me, were snapping hooks on the lines as they went out. He pointed, and I looked, and right at my feet, this little bird, and he's just huffing and puffing. He was panting. You could tell he'd probably been flying all night. And here he was, 60 miles from shore, and I'm sure that he saw the big light on our boat, and that's what he came for, to rest. And my thought was, the Lord knows where that little bird is. And the Lord cares that that little bird is there. In fact, the thought that hit my mind was, the Lord loves you, little bird. But then I thought, how much more, you said in your word, you care for me. He cares for you. Oh, that's the one. I want to put my treasure and my heart, have my heart on the one that cares for me. You ever feel like nobody cares for you? Jesus cares for you. He cares for you. He said in that 30th verse, your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. Jesus cares about your needs. He cares that you need shelter, that you need food, that you need clothing. I already know, in a sense, is what he's saying. I'm aware, and I care for you. That's where I want to put my treasure, on one that cares for me, someone who really cares. That 31st verse says, but seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. In other words, seek me first, and I'll take care of the rest. The Lord will take care of the rest of your life. You put him first. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be. And the Lord will just take care of the rest. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And this is Matthew 6:33, almost same thing. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Seek him first. Make him your treasure. Do that, and your heart will just automatically follow. If you love the Lord and you put him first in your life, why, he is just going to be your treasure. Everything in your life will revolve around that. That's where you want to be. The cares of this life, our Sunday school lesson was on worry. Who here doesn't worry? We all worry, I'm sure. Every hand would go up if we asked for hands. But the Lord says, you can lay these things, you can cast all your cares upon me, for he careth for you. That's what I want to do. I'm still learning. Still working on these things. But the Lord, he just leads us gently one step at a time to where we see him answer one prayer, then we see him answer another, and we see him work for us, and we start to trust him more and more. Amen. And then we're thankful for those times that he has helped us and those times that he has brought us through. Oh, I tell you, that's where I want to keep my treasure. That's where I want to keep my heart fixed on the Lord. I want to keep seeking him. Amen. It doesn't end at our basic experiences. We want to keep seeking the Lord our whole life. We're gaining those things that we can never lose. Everything else you gain in this life is temporary, as we said. I heard a little analogy. It's obviously not one that it was just a story, but there was a man that made a deal with the Lord. He said, can I take everything that I accumulate in the second half of my life to me with heaven? And it was agreed that he could. When he got to heaven, he had a bag. And when he is at the pearly gate, they said, no, that can't enter. And he said, no, I have a deal that we can bring this, everything I accumulated the last half of my life. And the angel there was curious what could be so important that it would be allowed into heaven. And he looked in and there was a bag of gold. And the angel said, pavement. You see, heaven's streets are paved with gold. What could we accumulate that would be greater than what we're going to receive in heaven? The Lord has prepared a place for us that is going to be so beautiful. I want my heart, my treasure, to be fixed on heaven. That's my goal. I pray that it's everyone's here goal to get to heaven. Keep the things that we cannot lose. Those are the godly things, the things that we would put into our spiritual life. That's where we're building when we pray, when we read our Bible, when we seek the Lord, seek him first. That's where our treasures will be. That's where our heart will automatically follow. Oh, I want to be with the Lord. I want to one day see his face and hear the words, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord. Yes. It will be worth it all. It will be worth it all the day we see Jesus. There's real joy in following Jesus. People are just searching for joy nowadays. People really just want to be happy. You won't be happy the way you can really be happy until you're saved, until you've had your sins forgiven. If you're not saved, you don't know what it's like to not have your conscience condemn you anymore. Let me tell you, it is such a peaceful feeling when God comes in and changes your heart, and there's just no more condemnation. Amen. I'll tell you, it's easy to put your treasure there when you know what the Lord has done for you, and you feel like it is with the day you got saved. Why, there's just nothing like it. I wish there was some way I could just put it into someone that's unsaved. I can't, but the Lord can. And the Lord wants to. If you're not saved, the Lord wants to make you happy. Happy is a man whose Lord is God. You want to be happy? Don't look to Disneyland or entertainment or everything. Look to the Lord. That's where there's happiness. If that's where your treasure is, you're going to be happy. You don't need to be a millionaire. You can be happy and be broke. Because the Lord will take care of you. Took care of those ravens. He took care of the lilies of the field. It says Solomon in all his glory is not arrayed as like one of these. I don't want to look scrappy, but the Lord, He gave me clothes that fit. He gave me clothes that looked decent. And I think, Lord, you've taken care of me. Amen. And he wants to take care of you. He will. If you trust him, you can know his peace down deep in your soul. Amen. There is really no greater treasure than that. If you've invested everything in him, that's where your heart will go. The deeper you go, the greater your treasure will be in him. He'll save you. He'll sanctify. He will baptize. And there's so much more. There's so much more. If we look over in Matthew 13, it tells about that man that found the pearl of greatest price. He found something that he knew was the best pearl ever. And it says that when he found it, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. He would not be denied. When he found the greatest pearl he'd ever seen in his life, he said, I have to have it. And he sold everything. I don't know what he had, but he sold it all. Why? To purchase the pearl of greatest price. This gospel is that pearl of greatest price. Yes. He was willing to do anything to get it. Are you willing to do anything to have this precious gospel? Are you willing to do anything to have the peace of God down in your heart? I will tell you this, it will be worth it. When we see Jesus, it will be worth it. Even before we see Jesus in this life, living with the Lord, there is no better life. It is so wonderful to know Him as our Heavenly Father. Where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where is your treasure this morning? Is it on the things of God? Or is it somewhere out there on stuff? You know, that story of the ship really hit kind of close to home for me. Had a friend in high school. And it's almost word for word what happened. I know Brian knows him, Kenny Martin. The boat was going out of the push and it was sinking. And they were yelling to Kenny to get in the life raft. And for some reason, he ran back down into the bunk quarters and the boat sunk. And Kenny was never seen. I thought, what could be more valuable than your life? There is nothing. But Jesus said, I came to give you life and give it more abundantly. Yes. Treasure the never-dying soul that the Lord has given you. Treasure that with everything. And by doing that, you're going to seek Him first. He'll add all the other things to your life that you need. He'll take care of those needs. But more importantly, you will be ready to meet Him. There is no greater thing that you could ever do than to give your heart to the Lord. When you do that, that's where your treasure will be. If you don't know Him, we're going to have a chance to come and pray. I'm thankful we still have altars. I'm still thankful that we have a place where we can unload that heavy load that we have on our life, and the Lord will make you His treasure. And you will treasure Him. Song is 7:13, but if the Lord is calling you, if He's talking to you, just say, Lord, I need You. Lord, I want You to be my main focus. And the Lord will hear your prayer, He will answer, and He will come into your heart. 7:13 is a song, but let's go to prayer.
Dear Lord, we're so thankful once again this morning that we have a chance to pray. And Lord, help us all to make that decision. We want to make heaven our home. We want to serve You. Help us to know where our treasure is, Lord. For some people here, anyone doesn't know really where their treasure is, you can find it this morning at these altars of prayer. And we thank you for this opportunity. Be with those that must go. Thank you for all that you've given us, and that we can be together and worship you and sing your songs and just bless around the altars of prayer. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.